So what I'm going to be using here is I've got a text editor, so I'm using VS Code, so Visual Studio Code. I've got a command prompt just so I can show you how you'd sort of run a script. You can use PyCharm, Jupyter Notebooks, or whatever interactive interpreter you want to use. And then I've also got the documentation here just to give a couple of examples of how you would search for things. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to activate my miniconda installation of the CSD Python API. Just to note, I'm in C drive in the training folder. And the reason I'm in there is because I can have read and write permissions, so I don't have to worry about admin rights. So I'm just going to quickly activate my environment. There we go. And so clear that. So we can tell it's activated because we have this base bracket here. And if you've not used conda before, that essentially tells you what kind of environment you're in. And so the first thing I want to show you is how you would use the Python API. So how you even access it. So I'm going to be making a reading file. So first thing you want to do is you want to import the IO from the CCDC module. So from CCDC import IO. What this essentially does is just gives you all the reading and writing classes. And we want to do an entry reader. So we want a reader. So we say from IO, get the entry reader. And here you tell the reader, well, okay, where am I reading from? I'm telling it, I'll go to the CSD. That's where I want my entry from. Then I say, I want an entry. And the entry that I want, so from the reader, give me the entry for, let's do paracetamol, 28, my favorite one, for no reason. So what this will do is this will go to the CSD, it will grab that structure, and it will return it to me as an object. And the I'm going to put in a couple of print commands just to show you what kind of information you can get out. These are just examples. There's a lot more you can get out of it. So let's say we want the ref code. So I'm using an F string here just because I think outputs look nicer. So identifier. And if I save that, and if I go to my command prompt and I run that, you see here that we get a return. The identifier for that is the ref code, which is why I submitted, which is great. And I could probably say, oh, maybe you're cheating and you're just returning back that string you've just passed to it. I'm not, because if I ask it for some properties, so let's say the formula and then the calculated density for that entry. If I rerun that, you can see here, I get the chemical formula of paracetamol and the calculated density for that. And that's it. That's how you access a structure, essentially in three lines of code here, if you like. Now, from the entry, we could go straight to the crystal. If I want to access the crystal, all I have to say is, well, crystal, so that's my variable, from entry dot crystal. That's it. And that's how you can get hold of your crystal object. Now, to show you that it is a crystal, I can ask for the cell angles. And if I save that, then run in here, you can see that what I get returned back is a name tuple, which contains the cell angles for paracetamol. And so here we have them stored in their own variables. And just as another example of that, I can access different types of properties. So if I ask for the crystal system and the space group symbol, let's save those. See, it returns back, oh, your system's monoclinic and it's a P21 over N. And just to show you how you'd find this in the documentation, this is what I do. You can scroll down to the bottom and go through the crystal API things there, or you could search in here. So I'll say crystal. So this will return every instance where crystal is found within the documentation. And the first one is the one you want to just see what's there. You can see here all the different things you have in it. So you have cell angles, lengths, cell volume, and so on and so forth. Honestly, the list is very, very extensive. And yeah, just wanted to make sure that you're aware that that was there. Just going to make this bigger. Set that up. Right. And then how do we access the molecule? Well, as I mentioned before, the molecule is stored within the crystal or the entry, depending on how you want to access it. For the sake of continuation, I'm going to access it from the crystal. So molecule equals crystal dot molecule. and that's it. So how can you tell it's a molecule? Well, it has atoms. So if I want all, I want to know the number of atoms in here. So number of atoms, and then I say from the molecule, give me the atoms, right? So from this, I should get a number spat out, although it won't be a number because the way it works, what you get back is a list of atoms. So the molecule, so the atoms are stored as a list of objects within the molecule itself. And so that means that, for example, if you then want the number, you just get the length of that list, and that will tell you how many atoms you have in there. The reason for storing it this way will become apparent in a minute, but it does make accessing atoms very easy. And so what would you want to know about a molecule? Well, I don't know, is it organic? So is mol organic? So, or a molecule, is it organic? Then run that, just clear that. Hey, how about that? Paracetamol is organic. There's other flags you can pass to it. So things like, is it organometallic? There's loads of, documentations. That's where you find them all. So as I mentioned, the atoms are stored they're stored in a list. So if I want to have a look at an individual atom, I'll go to molecule and I'll go to atoms again, and I'll just pick the first atom from that list. So that's how you index on a list, if you weren't aware. And then how do I prove it's an atom? Well, very easy, written the coordinate. And then if I print that, so I print Python. We have some coordinates. Now, these are Cartesian coordinates. Of course, you can ask for fractional coordinates and many more. Well, not many more of the types of coordinates, but just many more of the properties. And so here you can see the fractional coordinates are printed underneath. A good couple of features that I particularly really like is occupancy and neighbors. So with these, if I clear that, it tells you the occupancy of the atom, and you can get a list of the neighbors that are bonded to that atom. And I think this is really powerful because you can very quickly start traversing across a molecule just to see how the atoms are connected. And you can also get a list of all the bonds, of course, within a molecule, but I quite like this feature. So I'll just let you show you that. So as I mentioned before, we have different reading and writing sort of interfaces for the different classes. So that's the entry, the crystal, and the molecule. So you could do what I've just done here, which is read in the entry and then get the crystal, the molecule, and the atoms. Or the other option is you could create a new reader and read in the crystal straight away, for example. So here I'm using a crystal reader, and I'm going to tell it, go to the CSD and get me the crystal. And the crystal that I want from the reader is hexacan. So this will get essentially the exact same structure, but the only difference is it won't contain all the general information. It will contain the crystallographic information we had before. So if I show you what that looks like, you will see that I've just copied the exact same things that I was looking at before. So cell angles, crystal symmetry, and so on. So if I run that, you see that we're getting the exact same output. So here are our cell angles, monoclinic, and the space group. And then you can obviously do exactly the same for the molecular reader. I'll just very quickly show you that by just copying and pasting this. And then run that. There we go. So from the molecule reader, here, I put in one line just to save space. You see, we still get 20 atoms, and we still get is organic is true, which is great. Now, let's say that you found your favorite structure and you want to save as a SIF. So the way you can do that is by using our writing class. Now, for every reading class, we have a writing class as well. So same as before, I'm just going to copy this bit here. So reading in paracetamol, just so we have a structure to work with. And then I'm going to create a file. So I want to give it a file path. Now, I'd always recommend creating an absolute file path just because it saves on confusion as to where your files are after you save them. Relative is fine, but yeah, it's just better practice thing. So because I'm on Windows, I'm using backslash. If you're on Unix, you're going to be using forward slash, just keep that in mind. And the R flag is there to stop any double slashes, which you need for Windows. And so the way that we use the writer is the same way as you would write a file in Python in general. So you have to open it and then you have to close it, or you use a with, like a with loop. So with io.crystal_writer. So here we're using a writer instead of a reader, but we're still using it from the IO module. I'll give it a file path to say, save this file. And then I'll create it as an object. So crystal writer. So now we're saying is that this here is essentially an instance of this with this file path. So using the crystal writer, I tell it, okay, now you know what, you know where to go to write the file. What I want you to do is I want you to write this crystal. So, oh, sorry, let me load in a crystal. That would have been awful. Imagine if I did that. There you go. So here I'm basically just grabbing the crystal from the entry, and then I'm saving it here. What I always recommend is that you need to really tell your tell your command prompt or whatever you're printing out to what you've just done if you've made a file. So here I'm just trying to grab into one line. I've basically said print out crystal identifier has been written to, and then the file path. So then I know that that's been done. So if I run that. Aha. Of course, this was going to happen. excuse me for a second. What have I missed out here? Right. So this is when spelling mistakes come in as a problem. So for the crystal writer, the function that you want is write, not writer. Just, yeah, because you're telling it to write. Think of it that way. There we go. So now we have crystal hexacam 28 has been written to this wonderful sieve. Hey, there we go. We have a sieve. Perfect. Now, let's say that the situation is you found a sieve in the wild and you want to open it through the Python API. So we're going to use this sieve as an example. So previously, where we used the crystal reader, so in this case here, we pointed it at the CSD, right? What you could do instead is you could point it at a SIF file or a mol2 or any of the other file types that we support within the Python API. So here, what I've essentially done is I've created an instance of the reader and I've pointed it at a SIF file. I've told it, hey, look, I'm giving you a SIF. And because the SIF only contains one structure, I only want the first structure in that reader. Basically. And so what that will do is that will return the structure that's in the SIF file. And I will prove that to you by adding in these things here. So these are, let's make this, can I make this? There we go. Give a bit more space. There we go, much better. So same commands as before, the angle, the system, and the symbol. So if I write those, make sure it's saved. Otherwise, no changes at stake. So if I run that again, we can see here for the crystal reading a SIF file, we have the angles, the system, and the space group. Perfect. So we essentially have both done reading and writing for a single file, for a single structure.